Hello, I'm Leslie Lewis, CEO of the Ontario Science Centre. Welcome to our first Facebook Live event, Inspiring Inventiveness Beyond Da Vinci. Today, we've gathered four expert panelists to discuss the topic of inspiring the next generation of innovators. Da Vinci was a teenager when he sketched his first robots and other inventions. Is today's generation any better equipped to make new discoveries and change the world? Or are they suffering from information overload, held back by a fear of failure? We'll touch on this and many more questions from inside Da Vinci's workshop. If you're watching live, please post questions on our wall and we'll present them to the panelists. And now I'll hand it over to our moderator, Wendy Methley. Wendy.
Thanks so much, Leslie, and welcome to everyone here at the Ontario Science Centre's first Facebook Live event. So welcome to everyone in the virtual audience and also anyone listening in the Weston Family Innovation Centre here at the Ontario Science Centre. I know people are gathering there. So I'm delighted to be here today as the moderator of the groundbreaking Leonardo da Vinci workshop, the exhibition, which is serving as our backdrop for the discussion here at the Ontario Science Centre. We're here to discuss what prompted the today's theme, which is inspiring inventiveness beyond Da Vinci. So we're going to have a panel discussion. We're hoping that you will contribute lots of questions through Facebook to discuss innovation and Da Vinci. So we'll be looking at where innovation starts and how Da Vinci has impacted modern invention and inspired generations of thought leaders. And for you on Facebook, we would like you please to post questions for us on Facebook for our panelists. You go to the Facebook wall just below the video player there. And we're also inviting you to join the discussion on Twitter. There's a special hashtag for this, which is InnoVinci. InnoVinci with two N's. So please join us on Twitter, join us on Facebook. We will try and answer as many questions as possible that you pose to our panelists. So speaking of panelists, we have a number of themes that we're going to address today on Da Vinci, on innovation, what's happening in terms of innovation in Canada and beyond. So let me introduce them to you now. Michael Subinas, you may know him. He is a true Canadian innovator. Michael is the CEO and founder of Kobo, a global e-reading company. Hi, Michael.
Hi.
And next to Michael is Sandra Martin. She is the parent of two young girls, and she's also the executive editor of today's Parent magazine. And from Italy, Massimiliano Lisa, and if I get that wrong, I get to call you Matt.
Perfect, right? Thank you.
Massimiliano has come all the way from Italy to be part of the Leonardo da Vinci workshop, the exhibition. He is the CEO and founder of this exhibition that's traveled all over the world, and it's now here at the Science Centre. And next to him is Dr. Hooley McLaughlin. He is the Chief Science Officer here at the Ontario Science Centre. And thanks, everyone, for being here. So we're here to talk about innovation, inventiveness, based around an inspiration for the entire world, Leonardo da Vinci, who got started, we heard from Leslie, as a teenager. You got started as a teenager too, Michael. Tell us about that. And I heard that you were a child prodigy. When does it all begin and how did it begin?
For me, it kind of started with rockets and fascination with space. I remember coming here to the Science Center as a kid on one of those bus trips. I saw moon rocks and, you know, some space exhibit. And I hooked up with a great teacher that really gave me the opportunity, I think, to explore that further and introduced me to the science fair, which is, you know, if you're in a school with a bunch of buddies that all play sports, you know, and you're in the jock crowd, it's like the death sentence to be, you know, the science fair winner. But I did that, and then I kind of won the next one and the next one. And I met a bunch of guys from NASA, and I got really interested in rockets. And
when you were in high school?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so it kind of started at that point, and it just has snowballed from there.
So it was you became cool to be a nerd in high school?
I'd like to think so in my own mind's eye, but I don't know if everybody else saw it that way. But for me, it was fun. It was about, you know, building new things and making other things better and learning, and I got to meet a lot of cool people and, you know, that led me eventually to Silicon Valley and starting companies and
wow.
building new technologies. So it was a lot of fun.
So Sandra, you're a parent, and at today's Parent Magazine, Leslie was talking about, is there information overload for kids today? Is there a fear of failure? What do you think?
I think kids are really born with infinite possibilities in their own minds, most importantly. I mean, that's what we're talking about here, is not being limited by what's been done before or current ways of doing things. And as you go through the school system, as you begin to have expectations put upon you, I think the tendency, the desire to fit in, makes you kind of release that sense of I can do anything and I shouldn't worry about what other people think. So I think what we can do for our kids is really say, it's all right for you to think out, like, we want you to think outside of the box. Like, look at all of these people who've become successful because they did things a little differently. Unfortunately, I think there's a bit of a tension in the school system in that the focus is on preparing kids for careers that already exist, helping them fit in. And those are the kinds of things that can chip away at innovativeness.
So they should be like Michael and take a chance and not just follow the herd.
And hopefully meet up with a great teacher who encourages that in you.
Well, Huli, you give out here at the Ontario Science Centre annual awards encouraging innovation. What's the thinking behind that?
Well, I was just thinking, just picking up on what Sandra was saying, we are trying to encourage young students to come to us with their inventions, with their innovative ideas. We've had a few years of it now. We've had some extremely exciting results. But the one thing I would note is this year we're trying it a bit differently. We're going out and looking for them, because I think what's happened is young people don't know when they're innovative. They don't understand that they could be breaking loose. When they're doing something extraordinary, you almost have to remind them that that's the case. So I said, this year we're looking for them, we're pulling them out, we're saying, we want you to submit. And we're getting many more submissions because of it.
Because they don't realize that their idea or their way of thinking is actually new?
That's right. They don't get it. They don't get that they are inventive. They don't get that they are extraordinary. And I think that this may be because of our way of teaching. I'm not sure if we encourage it enough. Perhaps we don't.
So, Massimiliano, you came up with the exhibit around that's being shown here at the Ontario Science Centre. Tell us about Da Vinci. Where did he have speaking of child prodigies, sorry, Michael, but Da Vinci, pretty special
guy. Sorry.
Where did his inspiration?
Yeah, we can think at him when he was a child. We are talking about children, education. He was an illegitimate son, and he didn't have the formal education of the time. So since he was young, he was a child, he was let free to experiment. We can think about his own writing. He writes backwards, because he started to write by his own, and because he was left-handed, he found more easy for him to write backwards.
Wow.
And nobody corrected him. I mean, he invented something, nobody, all the rest of the world was writing in another way. He wanted to write in that way, and as a child he was allowed to do that. And he continued that for all his life. So this is one of the key points of Leonardo.
He invented things that
nobody was doing in another way, in his own way. This doesn't mean it was always the correct way, but since he was a child, he started in that way. He was free to do what he wanted.
I did a bit of reading about Da Vinci, and it almost sounds like being illegitimate freed him up to not have those expectations placed on him.
Also,
so he would have had to follow in his father's footsteps otherwise.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. This is one of the key points. Another thing, inspiration for Leonardo, at the time inspiration was nature. Leonardo was observing nature, everything, how things happen in nature. And in his machines, he is always trying to reproduce what nature did in a mechanical way. And this was another of his source of inspiration. Then another key point, he was absolutely not afraid to make mistakes. So he was an innovator in everything he did. And for example, when he did the paintings, the mural paintings, the one in Florence, the Battle of Anghiari, which was a complete failure because he used a technique on the wall to obtain a certain kind of colors nobody did before him, and was a complete failure.
He didn't know, so he had the courage to go ahead.
He wanted to experiment what he thought was an innovation, and it was a failure. And so they covered his painting, and now we don't have it anymore.
Huh.
The same thing happened also in Milano for the Last Supper. What we have today of the Last Supper is very far from what he painted. Why? Because the technology used to paint also the Last Supper was not good enough. I mean, it was another trial of him, another experiment to have more vivid colors on the wall.
Well,
it was a failure too.
Experiments. We need experiments. We're starting to get some feedback on Facebook, and please, an encouragement to send in your questions that we can ask to our panelists, and to join the discussion on Twitter at the hashtag InnoVinci. I have to confess that I think Leonardo da Vinci is probably the coolest guy who ever lived, just because he did everything. But is science still cool? I mean, there are some cool, famous scientists, but who are they now? Is it still cool to be like him?
I think you have to think a little bit about Leonardo in his time. He was everything. He was the Renaissance man.
Do we have that now?
Well,
is that encouraged now?
I mean,
is it possible?
Is it possible is a good question as well, because our fields of study are now, there's so much to know in each area, but he combined art and science in a fluid way, and that seemed to stimulate his creativity. Do we see that happening today? And I think we do. I think we see that elegance. You look at the theoretical physicists who are studying the origins of the universe. That's pure mathematical art.
We have a question. Catherine Swanson from Calgary asks on Facebook, what do you think inspired Da Vinci? You were talking about that, Massimiliano. But
nature.
Nature. But also, you were saying maybe it's impossible to be inspired as easily as everything being invented. Is that what you're suggesting?
I think, Da Vinci was not only a brilliant artist, and I think most people know him for the Mona Lisa and his art. And yet he was also a master of so many different domains. Worldwide expert of so many different domains. Today, to create one of these innovations, I can speak from a company standpoint, you need to find masters, individual Leonardos, you know, designers, engineers, experts in electronics, to be able to put that together. And there's an art for sure in putting it together, but you need now groups of people where Leonardo was one person. I mean, I don't think that one person exists today.
Sandra, is it cool? Is science cool among kids these days?
Part of the curriculum in many school boards is to have a scientist come into the school and show kids, you know, what's behind a lever and where are levers in everyday life. And kids are really excited by that. They can go home and build a lever. So I think, you know, the spark of it is there. Kids do think it's cool. They start off thinking it's cool. So how can we help them keep thinking it is? So
true story.
Yeah, go ahead.
That was not queued up for today and the whole rocket science lead-in. My daughter has an after-school science club, which she chose on her own. She goes to a girls' school, and last night she brought home a rocket. They've been working on the rocket for 3 weeks now, and they're ready to launch it next week.
Dad must have been very happy.
It blew me away, and she was excited by it. And I asked her, I said, so what other clubs did you have the chance to choose? And there was hip-hop, and there was all these other ones. And she chose science, and I said, well, are you alone in the class? And absolutely, it was the most popular class. So there's still places.
So maybe there's a cool teacher who's letting them build rockets. That's what's happening.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
We have another question now from Khaled in St. Catharines asking on Facebook, do you think Da Vinci was an artist who enjoyed science or a scientist who enjoyed art? Massimiliano.
Both things were linked together. He was an artist in science, and he was a scientist in art. So we're very linked together. Anyway, he completed, if we think of him as an artist, he completed something like just 20 paintings and one mural painting we have today. And in comparison to that, we have thousands of designs of machines. So probably is the heart of Da Vinci was maybe I can say a little more on engineering, because we have thousands of designs of machines. And another common mistake, important thing, Leonardo took inspiration from what people did before him. He studied all his life the work of other inventors. Mm-hmm. So if you go on his codes, on his manuscripts, you find many designs, but you have to understand that many of those are just copies of machines that were done before him. So since
photography was... But even his designs are art, right? They're so beautiful.
Yeah, this is absolutely... It was unique because every design also of a machine is a piece of art, so this was unique.
But was he a mutant? He just seems to be superhuman.
If you want to know something more about him, another secret about Da Vinci, he wrote that he didn't want to get married because he needed to be all for himself.
Huh.
So, if you like Da Vinci,
wow,
you want to follow.
We have another question now. Hayes Steinberg from Toronto asks on Facebook, how do you guys think we could encourage innovation among today's youth? Maybe Sandra or Michael?
Well, I think we've touched on it a little bit, is allowing kids to kind of follow their impulses a little bit more.
Replay.
You know, the curriculum in school is designed to help kids get a job, get into university, get a job, and be successful on those terms. But
well, that's
we
what we hear all the time, that it's so competitive, you need 90% to get into university.
But if you're focused on the set curriculum, when do you have time to, you know, go work on your sketches? When do you have time to, you know, build a rocket or try an experiment that you read about in a magazine, or maybe try it 60 times and improve upon it? So that's, I think free play maybe is a part of it as kids get older, allowing them to have free time to pursue their interests. You know, and encouraging them that that's not when you go into your room with your DS and play video games, that's when you actually are doing something active and you're pursuing things that you're interested in.
I think teachers need to be empowered, and I don't know if it's training, resources, money, but certainly time. I mean, I had the benefit of some great teachers that were also my soccer coach and my hockey coach that actually had the time and dedicated the time, and they were paid to, you know, be there to a certain degree, and they were motivated to help. I don't know that teachers today have those resources.
I think teachers today really want to do that.
Yeah.
And if I may put a little plug in for the Science Center, this is the kind of thing that we're trying to encourage students and teachers alike to think about. Just free yourself up.
How do you compete, though? Leslie was talking earlier about information overload. You know, in previous generations, there was just television. Now it's so easy to spend your entire day on Facebook for kids. How do you, at the Science Center, how do you compete with all the screens?
I don't think we think of it as competition. We'd like to think that a Science Center just meshes in with what people's lives are like today. So we don't try to become an extension of somebody's technology at home.
But how do you build that, I guess, that desire, that lust for innovation here?
Mainly by having real experiences, physical experiences. And I think that the key is often in doing something that's physical, where you're thinking through your hands as well as your mind. You're doing something real. That's where we find the best activity. And I believe you'd find that, too, Michael, when you were working in school, you were doing physical things. You weren't just thinking of
making
it theoretically.
Things.
You were making things.
Oh, yeah. It was very tangible.
Yeah.
And I could show it to... certainly my parents, I could show it to other people, and I was motivated to try and make it better. And a lot of what I did was based on really not knowing the science behind it at the time. I mean, some of the science behind it, I don't think I hit until I was in my fourth year of physics.
And you didn't need to.
And I didn't need to.
You could actually play with it.
I could just play with it.
Yeah.
Well, and there's the whole, we can talk about who are the great innovators of today in a moment maybe, but Steve Jobs obviously comes to mind. He dropped out of school. He failed. It's, you know, maybe it's beyond teachers, and the Science Center is great, but there's something else that needs to be
done,
too.
There's a growing movement towards homeschooling. Particularly, it's often for kids who have learning disabilities or are differently abled, but sometimes it's for kids who just don't fit into the conventional school system. And some of those kids are brilliant because they're freed up to pursue the things that they're interested in.
That's a very small sector.
It's about 2% of the school-age population. But, you know, you talked about dropping out of school, and, you know, maybe Steve Jobs would not have been successful had he stayed in school. Maybe that freed him up to be a little bit more
creative. And you must see it. I mean, kids are addicted to their screens today. Is that helping innovation or not?
It's partly they're addicted to their screens, and they're so programmed. So in their their free time, when they don't have lessons, they don't have homework, they kind of unwind by, you know, instant messaging with their friends or playing video games. So there really isn't that luxury of letting your brain expand and wander.
We have another question from Peter in Toronto, asks on Facebook, how do I help my 8-year-old understand Da Vinci's significance?
This is a very easy question. He has time till March to come to the museum here and visit this exhibition, the Leonardo da Vinci workshop, which has the focus and the object is to have young kids, young people, everybody understand the mind of Leonardo in a wide range. So,
but what do you say to an 8-year-old to make them think that Da Vinci's cool when they don't know them and they're not yet here?
What do I say?
Yeah. What's so cool? I'm 8. What do you say?
About Leonardo?
Yeah.
I say, be a Leonardo by opening your mind, and like we said, don't be afraid to experiment and to follow your heart.
You could use some real examples from this show. An 8-year-old would really, really be excited by the flying machines.
Flying like a bird.
And imitating a bird. That's extraordinary.
Before there were planes.
Before there were planes, right. And the fact that he thought about that and he looked at nature and the fact that they could do it themselves.
I think for a kid who likes to draw, I'm just thinking of my 9-year-old at home, she would just love to see his sketches and the different stages the sketches went through. So if you're not in Toronto and you can't visit this exhibition, which would be a fantastic opportunity for a kid, here's where technology comes in handy. You can actually go online and discover Da Vinci's life.
I think a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old would be stunned that one person could do all this, that they can do. I often have this discussion with my kids. I mean, my oldest was 4 when we started Kobo 2 years ago. And 4 months later, there was a piece of electronics that one day showed up at home. And I told her, I said, you know, Daddy and some of his friends, you know, we made this. And that concept, like, what do you mean you actually made it?
Yeah.
Like, where did it come from?
Yeah.
You know, and I explained, well, it didn't just come from the sky. You know, we designed it on paper and on the computer, and then eventually we got other people, smart people from around the world, to help us make it, plastic, et cetera. And it was fascinating to watch her just absorb that and think, well, geez, not everything just appears. You know, people like her could actually...
And that's the key, that people like her, like anybody. We talked about the rare few, like, say, those who want to be homeschooled, but we should realize that all young people have this potential. It's all there.
And you guys both touched on something that we talk about in the magazine a lot, and that's, as a parent, you model what you want your kid to be striving for. So you've just modeled to your daughter that you can innovate. Anybody can do it. Dad did it, so I can.
So who are, I would love to hear some Canadian examples, but we can think globally. Who are, Massimiliano, who are the Da Vincis of today? Are there any?
If you wanted to say something about Canada, I have made some research about Canada and innovation and the market in Canada. We are talking about Leonardo as an innovator in aviation. He was the first to envision flight, and he wanted to build airplanes. So I have discovered that Canada is number 4 industry in the world for the aerospace industry. So in Canada, you are leaders for producing regional airplanes, turbine gas engines, landing gear systems. You are a leader in the world for visual simulators, or flight simulators.
But you know what? If we had to name those people, unless you're in the business, you wouldn't know them. You know, we don't put those people on pedestals the same way as we do sort of Hollywood figures. Who comes to mind for you?
Look, I think unfortunately today in the papers, RIM and BlackBerry is getting a lot of press for all sorts of not great reasons. But I'd have to say Mike Lazaridis is in recent
times.
The BlackBerry. I remember having the first BlackBerry, and I was in California. I think we just sold our first company, and I remember having that BlackBerry and getting those messages. It was like a marvel at the time to be able to get email on the go no matter where you were. And that was something that, you know, has evolved tremendously since then. It's sparked a whole new industry of smartphones and now tablets. And in large part, started with him.
Mm. Raleigh, can you think of anyone?
Well, you know, I know we talked about this before. And I do have to say that I know you said today, but I must emphasize the fact that when we look at our country, Canada, the vast regions, the climate that we have, I think this underlines why we are leaders in communication, for that matter. And I think this underlines why we're leaders in aviation, and that we've got great inventions in those areas. But I would go back to the First Nations people and talk about the fact that the nation was founded by people who had to live in extremely adverse conditions. If you look at the inventions, this is an exhibition in the future sometime, the exhibition of the early Inuit pioneers in the north who developed incredible mechanics and transportation devices. The canoe, the Canadian symbol, is known around the world. And this is continuing today. All of this communication and travel and transportation is part of that legacy.
We've got another question from our live audience. Anna is asking, Leonardo had a demanding duke. How important do you think that was for pushing his innovation? And do we need more demanding dukes? Maybe start with you, Massimiliano, on the role of the duke.
We do have the dukes today, which is the market, stock exchange, the investors. So we already have. If you are successful like he is, he was, you get the premium and you go on.
I think we need more dukes in Canada.
Anyway.
I'll throw that out there.
Government dukes or?
No, just more private investors. I mean, I think that's the biggest challenge here is that there's just not a ton of risk capital. People, and I can tell
you. So it's not just the kids who need to take risks.
You know, look, it affects even, I mean, look, how old was Mark Zuckerberg when he started Facebook? Right? He was in his Harvard dorm.
But he was looking for
19.
A date.
Yeah, but, you know, eventually he needed some money beyond his initial partner. And, you know, it's hard to get that money here.
So so is he going to become a duke then, now that he has all this money?
Very soon, it seems, yes. Yeah. He'll be able to buy a few dukedoms.
Sure. Anyway, in North America, you're much more lucky than we are in Europe because it's almost impossible for a young guy to get any money or financing in Europe. Yeah. It's impossible. You go to a bank and they ask you, do you have a house? Or how do you guarantee the money? Mm-hmm. If you don't have anything guaranteed, they don't give you.
You just have an idea. It's not good enough?
No, absolutely not. Yeah. Not in Europe. In fact, in Europe, we are going down.
Sandra, a question for you. This is back to the idea of that Leslie raised at the beginning of information overload. Angela Walker asks on Twitter, do we give our children too much information instead of letting them explore and figure out on their own? And does that inhibit innovation?
I don't know that you can give too much information. You can be too guided in how you provide
the
information.
Well, like the impact of Wikipedia. It's so wonderful, but it's sort of an...
And you could go through it for hours and still not, you know. It's almost like reading the encyclopedia. I remember having a set of encyclopedias in the living room as a kid, and you wouldn't sit down and read it, but you might sit down and read a whole Wikipedia entry. So I think that is limiting. You can't give too much information, but you do have to also give the time for kids to...
Yeah, well, I know in journalism, you know, you need something, you just Google it, and then there it is. But, you know, I'm so ancient, I remember I used to actually, like, call people and meet people and go to libraries. So
well,
are we...
It's the time more than the information, then, isn't it? I mean, we always have been flooded with information of various types, but now we seem to be occupied with the information sources, and it's eating up our time.
Well, and it's a widening and a narrowing. Are we better? Are we in a better place to innovate?
Oh, yeah. Look, I think... we've been distinguished as a species by our ability to accumulate information, right? Which no other species does. So this building on, you know, what came before is something that we uniquely do. And I think with Google and the internet and screens, Wikipedia, you know, I can tell you, my 4-year-old knows how to go and get a piece of information, to go get an answer, to help her do something else. So I think, you know, the tools are awesome today. To be able to build on.
Let's go back to talking about Leonardo, our friend Leonardo. He's been dubbed the greatest innovator of all time. He was an artist, he was a scientist, he was an engineer, he was an inventor, mostly. Here's a list of things that plans that led to inventions like the airplane, the helicopter. He also developed mechanical innovations including bridges, musical instruments, the hydraulic pump, cranes, construction devices, all kinds of weaponry. Hooley, most people know him for the Mona Lisa, perhaps, but he also offered so much in terms of biology and scientific advancement. What's his contribution to science?
Well, it's a very interesting question. You mentioned biology, and of course his investigations into the paintings and human anatomy were incredibly extensive. He was one of the first people to look into anatomy itself and to do dissections and look at that. It led to discoveries which we know are just take for granted today in medicine, for example. And then we talked about flight and his analysis of nature and looking at that in detail. But when you ask that detail, that question at the end, what is his contribution to science? He was working for himself, granted with a lot of dukes taking care of that. Much of what he did was not fully discovered in his time. And we are rediscovering things which he thought of many, many years later, centuries later. So it's hard to say. Contributions to the development of science at the time, not as much as perhaps it should have been. But contributions to the thought of the world and the history of ideas, enormous. Because his thinking, even today, is influencing us, making us think differently.
Michael, you're an engineer. What did he contribute to engineering? Mm. And if he were around now in that field, what would he be looking at, do you think?
Look, I think engineering is a lot of not just science, but the art and science of, you know, solving problems and ultimately, you know, making things better, improving things for people. And, you know, that mosaic of bringing together multiple disciplines, I think, is probably the lasting, you know, imprint on engineering. And it's personally why I chose engineering versus, you know, a pure science. I wanted to bring in many different disciplines, whether it was history or, you know, geography, geology. So what would he be working on today? It's a great question. I
guess if you knew, you'd have a few dukes behind you.
Yeah, no, it'd be great to have a few dukes. Certainly nanotechnology. Look, I think there's a lot going on in terms of, well, if you could imagine, you could actually build things that were this small, what could you do? And I think it's a bit of a blank slate right now. So
and
it's great
true,
area.
At that level, the nanotechnologists and nanoscientists are calling themselves designers more and more.
Yeah.
And they're doing things of great beauty.
Yeah. With atoms. Like
with
it's
atoms.
Crazy.
They're building yeah. atom by atom. Yeah.
So we have another question from our live audience. Hannity asks, was Da Vinci going against the current of his day? Was innovation harder 500 years ago or today? Massimilian.
Yeah, absolutely. Was harder to be an innovator at the time of Da Vinci. So today we have the mind, we have the technology, we have everything to be more innovative. But to add something to what you asked before, the contribution of Da Vinci inventions to the advance of technology was non-existent at all, because he invented everything, as we say, but he was not able to publish anything. So all his projects about the flight, about pumps, about engineering, about the studies about the human body, he didn't concentrate on, I think, enough time to have the time to put together a manuscript and then to have a book printed, because at the time there was already the technology to print books. So all his work was completely lost for centuries, and we rediscovered his codices only in the 19th century. It was too late, because all the things he anticipated were already coming out.
Wow.
So
he would have been like a gazillionaire, like Zuckerberg would have been like.
This is a great failure of Leonardo. The thing, he didn't have the time to focus on a project and to complete also, because he wrote it, he had the project to do an engineering book, a book about the flight, about everything, but you don't complete anything.
But Massimiliano, that's not a failure. Because I think that's what I was trying to allude to before, that the legacy for science is complicated, because we are only now discovering Leonardo, and exhibitions like this. Your own research is actually helping us.
Yeah.
But he exemplifies what we all are about. We're about living a life that's full and rich. And he really did try very hard to be the most imaginative person every day of his life.
Yeah, he was like this.
That's a powerful, powerful message for young people.
For now. Now, yes.
Yes,
but
yeah.
For centuries,
yeah,
for no.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Another question we have from Tiffany on Twitter. Would Da Vinci be impressed with innovation today? Michael, you were...
His mind would be blown.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also, he would have been published, because anyone can self-publish now. Even kids. I just got a press release about a way you can get your kids to author their own books. So if they want to write a book with illustrations, you can get it published for them. And
well,
it doesn't
I mean, that's
cost
the other
much.
Thing that's happening
now
today
you don't
is they're all publishing.
Too, because you can publish it by yourself on the
absolutely.
Web.
Absolutely.
But there's so much. Yeah, like every kid thinks, I've got some brilliant idea, and maybe it's not. I mean, there is the other side of that coin.
That's kind of an interesting, you know, tension as a parent. Like, you want to encourage your kid, but you also don't want to raise an egomaniac. So that's another kind of difficult thing about fostering innovation. Yes, you have some ideas, but not all of them are going to be brilliant, and that's okay.
So here's a question. That if they're all publishing, how are you going to find the Leonardo?
Search engine.
Well, Massimiliano, yeah, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I was just saying that today you can publish, you can skip that point. You need a publisher, you need a broadcaster. You can broadcast yourself on the web, you can publish yourself on the web. So the possibilities of today are incredible. We are in a point in the human history where innovators, where kids, where everybody's an idea, has unlimited possibilities. So we can expect, we hope to see many Leonardo's.
The unfortunate thing is YouTube is being used by kids who want to go on stage with Lady Gaga as opposed to showing how their rocket works. So again, it's, you know, getting that encouragement to kids.
Yeah, how do you make the science fair cool again? Or is it? It's just that they're, it's not on Glee every night.
I visited with the guys at Intel that sponsor this science fair, this international science fair. It was a couple of years ago, and when I did it, there was two Canadians, three Canadians my last year that made it to this international fair. Now there's like this small army of them. Mm. And it's clearly more popular. It's getting funding, which is one thing.
From?
Part from Intel, so part from the private sector, and part from government, from the National Science Foundation. But it's clearly cool because there's, you know, there's great exposure. They get to go on a trip. There's a lot more to it than just, you know, showing your stuff. And I found actually for me one of the greatest value adds was just meeting other people and getting to talk about other people with, you know, about what they did. I remember this kid beside me at this last International Science Fair had this just a book. It was like a remember the duotangs? I don't even know if you can get a duotang anymore, but it was a Hungarian kid, and he had discovered this 300-year-old math problem. He discovered the solution to it. And just working on his own, you know, nobody in his family was a mathematician, and he was like a fascinating guy to meet and, you know, stay in touch with after 20 years.
You've been poring over everything that he ever did that's now available anyway, and I'm reading his notebooks, some of which are still being released now. What is it when people come to an exhibition, your exhibition, what is it that they're most surprised by?
They're surprised by understanding that we are just revealing a little bit of Leonardo, because there are something like 6,000 pages of Leonardo to be studied.
Wow.
And in this exhibit, we just give a glimpse, and there are still hundreds and hundreds of machines to be reconstructed. Mm-hmm. So the work is still, for us,
what
of interpretation.
What was his mind like? What do the notebooks show about his
mind like a network. We can think of like an hyper link of things today. We are used to have the hyperlinks on the web. And so his mind was already working something like 500 years ago.
So did he
like
ever
we are
sleep?
Working today.
Did he probably had a little
tape
recorder by the bed.
He wanted to have he was sleeping not so much. And as I told you, he didn't want to have a relationship also because he wanted a lot of time to study, to make things. So, yeah, the issue is time. The problem is he had a limited time, and we have a limited time. Another thing I want to add is that not everybody can be a genius or an inventor or a painter. So we don't have also to stress our kids. I mean, there will be also a bunch of normal kids that will live a normal life, and it's perfectly acceptable. I mean.
Well, not everybody can be like Leonardo. Yeah. They don't sleep, they don't have any relationships. Yeah. You know.
So the beauty of the world is that all of us are different. So
Do kids learn, Sandra, about Da Vinci today? Is he part of the curriculum?
Where's
the Da Vinci comic book? Maybe that.
I mean, Da Vinci is such a big part of pop culture that kids do learn about him, probably a little bit later than, you know, we might be thinking. I think my 9-year-old knows who he is, but not from school, but because she's interested in art and we talk about it at school. But I think, you know, getting that spark of who he is, there's just it's so appealing to a kid's mind that maybe parents need to be a bigger part of it. I mean, that's a big stress in the school system, is that parents are part of the learning process. And maybe we don't wait for school to spark that interest in their kids, whether it's about Leonardo da Vinci or about science or about rockets. We kind of take the time to introduce that ourselves.
So when families come here with their kids, what do they take away? What kind of reaction do you get from the exhibit?
Well, people are at first amazed because this is so stunningly beautiful with the models. And then when they get into the touchscreen computer renditions of the notebooks, where you look at the drawings and some of them come to life, come three-dimensionally, you can move them around, it feels like you've plunged into a different world. Mm. And I see families with children just being very quiet, talking quietly, and spending an enormous amount of time looking at it and feeling
change. What's the biggest hit of all the things that you can see here?
The biggest hit tends to be the flying machines, because they are just so extraordinary, and the idea that somebody could be thinking about flying time. But I think for young children, the computer, you can't compete with for young children. The screens really, really take it. And these are some of the best computer renderings I've ever seen in this show.
William from our live audience asks, how can a science center help school teachers to think outside the box? Quick one to you. Well, to everybody.
I think the great resource for a teacher here is it's access to things you can't get in the classroom. In addition, and your kids aren't sitting in their seats, you know, kind of glazing over. They're being active. And studies show that when you're doing, you know, to touch on what you said earlier, when you're doing, it reinforces learning. So that's a huge resource.
I think what we've always tried to do in the Science Center is to allow people to understand that play is essential to learning. And having the time to relax and just play with no agenda, no goals, that's the key to real innovative thought. We've done that from the very beginning here, but I think today it's even more important.
Here's an interesting one from Steve in the live audience. He's asking, how interested was Da Vinci in the underwater world? Apparently done drawings of underwater breathing apparatus. Scuba gear, was he into that too?
I can tell you he also made a project of the submarine.
Of a submarine,
yeah,
really?
And is a machine we just completed. We will present in Tokyo in May. So
what was he not interested in?
It's hard to say.
Like women.
Women.
Yeah. No, he painted some very beautiful portraits of women.
Anyway, my 12-year-old son, the name is Leonardo. So.
Oh, really? Okay. You named your son Leonardo.
And when people come to the exhibition, usually the older guys goes to the reproduction of the design, the physical ones we have. The parents go to the physical models, and the children goes to the computer screens. And usually at the end, they all unify. Around the touch screen, and usually it's the young kid that explains to the family the contents of the exhibition. So
it guides them into the touchscreen, which is actually quite daunting for older adults, but they get into it.
This is really nice to see.
So we're going to start wrapping up in a couple of moments, but what needs to be done in, I guess, more in Canada? You were saying more private money. What else? What do we need here?
I think coming back to the point on schools, I don't know how this gets programmatically put in place, but it's about giving teachers the time to be able to do things like bring kids to the Science Center.
And then to keep it alive afterwards, right?
Yeah.
And otherwise, it's just a neat trip out for the day, and then how do you...
Yeah, just instilling this idea that they can try things, and it's okay to fail, and they too can make something.
I would be very provocative about this, but if you really wanted to stimulate innovation in Canada, you have to look at the school system and the curriculum approach that we have, and to break away from the disciplinary separation of subjects. I think there has to be a radical shift in the way that schools sit students in classrooms at certain key times, and they're given exams, and they have to learn a certain set of information. This is a real killer for innovative thought.
You know, we're seeing a little bit of change away from that old model wherein kids are not just doing pages and pages of multiplication and they're not learning by rote. There's more of a focus on the application of knowledge and creative problem solving and group work. So
it's still
I think
good
we're
to
on
know
our
your
road.
Times tables, though, isn't it?
Well, you want to know that you're getting the right change back.
But
so there's this practical
learn your
side.
Time tables anyway in that context.
Yeah.
It would be you'd be motivated
I think
to
learn them better.
Yeah, you would learn them better.
It is changing, and the curriculum has been reprogrammed and tweaked so that kids are learning how to apply that knowledge, and so it's not just that rote learning. They're learning how to apply knowledge and be creative. But there's still a long way to
We're
go.
We're still living in
you.
A 19th century classroom.
What's the key for you? Education?
From my
like
point of view of somebody
being
living
illegitimate.
Living in Italy, I can tell you that the system in Italy is completely different. The studies are very theoretical, and for example, what I studied for 5 years on the classic liceo classico, the main focus were we spent much of the time in studied answered Latin, answered Greek, so very far away from practical applications. And now a little bit is changing, but I think your approach is more successful. So that's why. In
writing
Canada,
backwards.
US,
we need to learn how to write backwards, maybe.
Why not? Maybe that's something to that. Just break away.
Well, how much of it is wiring of the brain, and how much of, it's...
At least socialization,
yeah.
Anyway.
I had a science teacher in high school who everyone thought was a kook and who would refuse to let us write notes in linear fashion. They were all these, like, crazy flow charts that he'd draw on the board. And he actually gave people extra marks for expressing the writing things in a different way, like the actual format. So, the kooky teacher is probably the one who's got the right idea when it comes to teaching innovation.
Yeah. So just a final thought from each one of you on the importance of Leonardo da Vinci and the importance of innovation, thinking outside the box, taking risk, all of that. Michael?
I think this exhibit and Leonardo is just a great recognition of you know, anyone can come up with an idea and make something if they have the will and the time. This example that I gave of my daughter, I mean, it's an example that I had from being a kid, where my dad said, you know, if it's not you, it's going to be someone else that'll come up with that. So why not you? And if you think about it, Leonardo was born about 500 years ago. 500 years ago, I think at the decade before he was born, Gutenberg created the printing press. And 500 years later, how we create books, distribute them, consume them is changing. And what I'm doing today is a part of that. And it started 2 years ago with an idea that, hey, we could do this. We could create a global e-book or reading system that anyone can download any book ever written anywhere in the world onto any device in about 10 seconds, and it would be close to free. We could do that. And people thought we were crazy, but we went for it. And I think it's just proof that, anyone can do anything and innovate. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Michael. As a parent, I think the takeaway is that your child can be good at lots of things. You don't have to necessarily focus and prepare for one specific career. And, you know, as Massimiliano said, not every kid is going to be a genius, but your child can experience creativity and innovation to whatever degree is possible for him or her. And I think that's what kids will take away from this experience.
What do you want them to take away?
One thing we try to achieve in this exhibition, we don't present Leonardo da Vinci as a genius, you can't arrive. But everything we present, a machine, a painting, everything he did, we have interactive stations where the kids and everybody can dissection what he did and understand really what he did. So by understanding that even behind complex subjects, there is a simplicity, by understanding maybe you can do it, our goal is to push the creativity of the young generations. So we hope that out of several thousand people, some new Leonardos will come out also from the Ontario Science Centre.
So this is here until mid-March. Where do you go after this?
Yes, to mid-March. And
then
After that, probably we'll go to Arizona in U.S. But in May, we will open a museum about Leonardo in Tokyo.
In Tokyo.
Yeah, so we'll be...
Cool.
We've already been in Asia, but we'll be our second time there. All over the world, the reactions are pretty much the same. So.
Hula, your final thought?
I would like people to take a good look again at Leonardo. When they come into here, they get so immersed in his science, engineering side, that you have to remind yourself that this is the Leonardo we all know, who's the great painter. And
right.
And when we realize that, we realize that he didn't differentiate between art, science, or any discipline. And I would love people to take that away and realize that in their lives, they don't have to think of themselves as one particular type of person, one particular career, but rather that these things come together, and there's great beauty in all the things you can do. There's great invention in every area of your life. To just feel that openness, and for us at the Science Center, it would be wonderful for people to realize that science is simply part of life, part of culture, part of everything. And the Leonardo saw no distinction. I'd love them to take that away and to feel really free, totally free, to be creative themselves and to feel that they could do it from any angle they would like to do it from.
Well, it was great fun to hear from all of you, and I think we've learned that people are still fascinated by Leonardo da Vinci, and that fostering that idea of innovation is a very important thing, because it just helps make the world more interesting and a better place to live. So we're going to wrap up the live discussion now. We're still actually getting more feedback from people on Facebook and Twitter, so please carry on that discussion there. That can continue. Our live discussion here is over, so thank you so much for joining us from our Facebook viewers, and thank you so much to the panelists. It was really interesting to hear all of your perspectives. It's an unending conversation, I think, about Leonardo. So please keep the discussion going on Facebook, and the highlights and the full discussion, you can check that out if you want to afterwards. It will remain on Facebook for a while at facebook.com/Ontario Science Centre. Thanks, everyone, and thanks to you.